Hey, LeVar, it's all good. I'll just go ahead and get started while you work on the echo, okay? Hi, everybody. My name is Simon T. Bailey, and I am a proud board member of the US Dream Academy. I'm so deeply honored that you would take time out of your busy schedule to join me this afternoon for this session. So here's what we are going to accomplish in the next few minutes. I'm going to take us through how do you really begin to spark your restart. And as we begin to walk through this time together, I really would like to create a dialogue and a conversation with you as best we can, even through the virtual means that we have. So if you post in the chat, I will see your name. And so that I know that you can hear me clearly, if you can just say yes in the chat, let me say hi to Tanya, Barbara, Anita, Sandra, Sharissa. So if you can hear me in the chat, just put yes in the chat. You can hear me loud and clear. And that will allow me to continue to move forward because I know that you are with me. Okay, yes. Thank you, Barbara. So appreciate that. All right, awesome. So for those that I'm meeting for the first time, I live in a little small town called Windermere, Florida, outside of Orlando. I have been in the Orlando area. Oh my goodness, next year will be 30 years. What? Oh my goodness. Hey, Dippin, how are you? Good to see you. Hope everything's good in Houston. So, yeah, I've been in Orlando almost 30 years. And professionally, I have 35 years of experience in the hospitality industry, six different companies, 10 different jobs. And for the last 19 years, I have worked with almost 2,000 organizations in 50 countries. Every single day, I wake up to find a way to equip and encourage organizations to unlock the hidden potential in their most important resource and asset, that being people. I worked at Disney for a number of years and decided to leave Disney 19 years ago. And so for really last 19 years, I've been working with companies. So as you can imagine, 18 months ago, I lost six figures worth of business inside of 7 days. Okay. And I was not smiling. I was not feeling the love. And I was probably for the first 30 days more bitter than better. All right. Anybody with me, any honest folks with me, if you were at some point bitter over the last 18 months because of the pandemic, can you just put yes in the chat? I just want to make sure that I'm not alone. Yes, it's true. At times, misery loves company. So I recognize that I really needed to do something about the situation that I was in. And oh, by the way, if you're wondering if this is a real background behind me, yes, this is a real background. Thank you, Barbara Wallace. These are real books. And my wall is painted red. So, yes, my wife said to me that you need to paint your wall red and color coordinate your books. And I said, yes, dear, that's what we're doing. So, anyway, I recognized that there was something that needed to change. I needed to spark my restart. And I happened to be talking to a friend of mine, Kathy, that lives in New York City. And we're just catching up. And I said, how are you doing? And she said, Simon, I am taking my meds. And I was like, what? What do you mean taking your meds? She said, if you're going to spark your restart, you have to meditate, exercise, diet, and sleep. Take your meds. And I would love for someone to post that in the chat comment section so everyone sees that. Meditate, exercise, diet, and sleep. Take your meds. So let's unpack that, right? Most of you know that for thousands of years, meditation has been something that has been talked about, and implemented in the eastern part of the hemisphere. In the Western hemisphere, where we live, for probably almost the last 30 years, the Harvard Business Review has released a number of articles around mindfulness. So let's fuse these two thoughts together: mindful meditation, and it's the ability to slow down in order to speed up. how you start the day determines the day. So if I'm truly going to spark my restart and take control of the future, how do I ensure before I leave my house, before I leave my residence, before I do anything, or even if you're working from home, how do I ensure I carve out time every single day to reset my mindset, no matter what I may face that day, okay? So meditation, there's a couple of apps that I would suggest, and I'm gonna just type them here. Thank you, Dipin, for typing that. There's an app called Calm, and there's another app called Headspace. And these are apps, disclaimer, I have no affiliation or connection with them. You know, you have to say these things nowadays. He just mentioned an app. He must be getting something on the back end. I'm not. So Headspace and Calm are two great apps that you can set a timer, 3 minutes, 5 minutes, 15 minutes, just to begin to slow down to the speed of life. Meditation, exercise. Now, I know you can't tell because I'm here on camera, but I had gained about 20 pounds because I was just binge eating French fries. I would go and get takeout. Was anybody binge eating, or was I by myself? Just put yes in the chat that you were also binge eating. All my truthful folks. So I was binge eating, but I needed to start exercising because I had talked to my doctor, and my doctor told me that I had put on a lot of weight and my A1C number was not where it needed to be. And I happened to be talking to my mom, and mom is 81 now, 81 years young. And she said, baby, you know, sugar runs in the family. I said, mom, it's called diabetes. It's called diabetes. So I recognized I needed to start exercising, dieting, and sleep. Can we just talk about sleep for a moment? I know sleep is not talked about in a session like this, but it's so important. All of you are aware of the benefits of ensuring that we get proper sleep, because sleep has the ability to emotionally reset us from the inside out. So one of the challenges for me over the last 18 months is I generally get up between 3 and 4 a.m. I go to bed around 9 p.m., but I'm up at 3 ready to go. And I probably have been up another time throughout the night. So one of the things that I really have been working on is to get more sleep. All right, how many of you, when you think about meds, meditate, exercise, diet, and sleep, which one of the four resonates with you the most? And what have you learned as a result of that experience? And I'm asking you this question because I really believe the brilliance is in the chat. To hear what has worked for you will really help us understand how do we spark our restart. Now, you're probably saying, okay, Simon, that's great. Why is that important? If we really understand how you start the day determines the day, and throughout the day, there will be moments when everyone will want a piece of you virtually or in person. You go from meeting to meeting or call to call, session to session. So this ability to take time for you. Now, here's why this is important. According to Gallup's research from the Global Workplace Study Report, a 191-page report that was released 6 weeks ago, I'm not going to take you through all 191 pages, but let me give you the Cliff Note version of what they're saying. The new imperative for organizations, businesses, for-profit, nonprofit, individuals, self-employed, employed, is employee wellness. Each individual thinking about how do they take care of themselves, and having this ability to say, how do I take care of myself, ties into the wellness benefits, self-care, or a person just saying, you know what? I am going to protect, nurture, and grow my happiness, my health, and my wholeness. So that means, oh, brilliant one. That's right. I just called you, oh, brilliant one. If you are indeed brilliant, just put yes in the chat. Yes, I am brilliant. And I'm sure some of you say it. I'm glad you finally recognized. So if I'm truly going to be healthy, happy, and whole, how do I begin to take my meds? That's the first big takeaway, all right? Second big takeaway is remember that hope is your superpower. Thank you, Barbara Wallace said, I'm brilliant. Can I get a what? I'm brilliant. Hope is your superpower. And I want you to just think about that for a moment. During this time of what many call a VUCA environment, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, whoever has the most hope has the most influence. Dr. Rick Snyder was a scholar at the University of Kansas, and 30 years of his research was around this whole idea called hope theory. What he says in his research is that in the midst of uncertainty, individuals who understand the power of hope tap into willpower and way power. When we talk about willpower and way power, it's the ability to find the internal agency to hope again. Now, hold that thought for a moment and let me take you down another rabbit trail, and I'm going to fuse this whole concept together. Jim Clifton, in his book, The Coming Jobs War, there's a section and a chapter in the book dedicated to looking at the educational system here in the United States. According to his research, there are about 75 million students from 5th to 12th grade in public schools. According to Gallup's research, 50% of these students will not graduate on time, and 30% of the 50% are African-American or Hispanic. When the Gallup scientists do the deeper research and the deeper dive to understand why is it that students are not graduating on time and why is this even a bigger issue in deal in African-American or Black and Hispanic households. And what the Gallup scientists discovered, it's not as if the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Kauffman Foundation, and you name it, you know, ABC Foundation is not writing a check to give towards resolving this problem of dropout. The Gallup scientists discovered the reason students drop out is because they lose hope. They lose hope for a better future beyond graduation. And having no hope beyond graduation, not only do they psychologically drop out of class, even though they may physically be showing up, the lights are on, but nobody's at home, the reason they almost psychologically check out is because they have witnessed or come from a household or a situation that is hopeless. So when I looked at that, I heard Dale Bronner, who is based in Atlanta, phenomenal thought leader, author, global influencer. He said, a helpless person is a hopeless person, but a helpful person is a hopeful person. So hope is your superpower that becomes a magnet that pulls you towards the future. So then let's unpack this a little bit more, because according to Harvard, there are four styles of learning whenever you present and have the virtual stage. Style number one is, why should I listen to you? Style number two is, show me the data or proof. Style number three, give me three things to take away from this time. And style number four, I'm overwhelmed with a terabyte of information. According to Google, people see 2 million ads within a year. I just need one thing to do. So here's what I want to invite you to think about in order to be more hopeful. I want to invite you to grab hold to the steering wheel of your life. So everyone right now listening to me, take your hands, put them up half mast. And I want you to imagine that you are wrapping your hands around a steering wheel. And I want to invite you, if you are going to be more hopeful, understanding that hope is your superpower, I want to invite you to look through the windshield
of where you're going instead of the rear view mirror of where you've been. And when you look through the windshield of where you're going, I want you to begin to be hopeful and imagine, who am I becoming? Who do I get to be? How do I ensure that I know that I belong? And when you understand being, belonging, becoming, you look through that windshield and you're like, what? I don't have to look through the rear view mirror. I can look through the windshield of possibilities. For the last 6 months, I have been matriculating with a cohort of 40 medical professionals. I'm the only non-medical professional in this cohort. And we have been studying some of the work by the scholar named Dr. Gene Watson, who for the last 40 years has been talking about care and science. One of the things that we have really done a deep dive in as it relates to caring science, and I'm gonna tie this in with hope, is when you understand willpower, way power, according to Dr. Snyder, when I recognize I am in a place of hope, I have to be mindful of who is speaking into my ear and what information I am consuming. Because sometimes constant negative news causes us to operate in a negative frequency. And when individuals operate in a negative frequency, they spiral down. But when I am hopeful, looking through the windshield instead of the rear view mirror, I am hopeful and I begin to spiral up. And when I spiral up, or when you spiral up, or when we spiral up, we are operating at a higher frequency. So the question that I want to pose to you, which one is more important, to be or to do? I am going to err on the side to be, because when I am hopeful, it's no longer about a to-do list. It is about a to-be list. So who do you want to be as you spark your restart? What gives you hope? Here's what I'd love for you to do. Post in the comments right now, what makes you most hopeful when you think about where you are? What has sparked your hope? And I'm asking you this question because as we are interacting virtually and in person, the hope that we have rubs off on others, figuratively, not literally, by how we show up, our disposition, how we feel, what we think, what we say, how we carry ourselves. If hope is a superpower and we want to spiral up, then we really have to consider what language are we using? What are we feeling? What are we thinking? What allows us to continue to move forward into the future? So far, we've really looked at how do we begin to take our meds? That's number one. How do we now begin to be hopeful? And I want to take us through our third and final insight, and then I'm going to open up for any questions that you may have. And that third insight is, how do we ensure that we are learning and growing every single day? Over the last few months, I've had an opportunity to interview a number of people. One of the individuals that I've interviewed is Dr. Francesca Gino. Dr. Gino teaches PhD level courses in the Harvard Business School, and she teaches specifically PhD level courses around behavioral economics. I had a chance to be in the virtual green room with Dr. Gino, and I said, Dr. Gino, what is your research telling you right now about this time and how people have been able to thrive, not just survive? And she said something very interesting. She said, my research says individuals who have been paralyzed during this time, they were no longer curious about tomorrow. I'm going to say that again. individuals who have been paralyzed were no longer curious. So let's unpack curiosity. When I understand the power of curiosity, it literally is the ability to open up our hearts and our minds to not only read and listen and watch and absorb, but the curiosity and the questions that immerse us on the path of learning become a quest, question, quest to discover what's emerging, what's coming up. So this ability to be curious about where you are really is, let's look at four specific domains. How curious are you about spirituality, your spiritual growth, your spiritual development? I'll never forget years ago when I was just a mere pup starting out in this whole business of really trying to inspire people towards a path of brilliance. I had an opportunity to share the stage with the late, great Dr. Stephen Covey. And he was the opening speaker, Libby Sartain, who at the time was the chief people officer at yahoo.com. And there was this guy who was bringing up the rear. So I decided to sit in the back of the room because I wanted to hear Dr. Covey. And if you have not read his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, I highly recommend the book. Dr. Covey said something that forever shifted my thinking that day as I begin to consider this domain of spirituality. He said, and I don't know if this quote originated with him, but he said, we are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. And when he said it, it was just like a joy bomb. I was like, what? Who says that? Like, who says that? But I started thinking that through, and it reminded me of growing up. How many of you remember the quote, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names and words will never hurt me, right? Names and words will never hurt me. And how many realize names and words, they do hurt us. They impact our spirit, right? So when Dr. Covey said it, I said, spirituality, that's really interesting. Spirituality means different things to different people, but for the context of this conversation, how are you doing spiritually? How curious are you? For me, spirituality starts every single day. I have the Bible app on my phone, and I start with a video that is in the Bible app portal. I listen to the video, I read whatever the meditation is, I say the prayer, and that is my way every single day of ensuring that I carve out time so that I have a spiritual depth in my relationship. What I recognize is over the years in my spiritual walk, I had spiritual information that was a mile wide, but my relationship with God was an inch deep. So for me, I had to really begin to focus on what was I going to do just to grow spiritually. All right, second area, when we think about being curious, physical, right? Our health. How curious are we about taking care of ourselves? And what are we doing? I have my water here that I drink often. I just noticed that this water bottle says, focus on the family. I think I need a US Dream Academy water bottle. I'm just saying, just a thought. So physical, how are you doing? Second or third area is mental. How curious are you? What are you reading? What's feeding you? What are you listening to? There are a number of books that are behind me. Two books I highly recommend is a book called Your True DNA, written by Thomas Wininger. Had a chance to talk to Thomas a year ago. Wow, time flies. A year ago, I was in London. I had to self-quarantine for 14 days because a client had invited me over to Europe to speak at their VIP client event. So I had self-quarantine in London for 14 days, flew to Milan. They picked me up in a private car and drove me to Switzerland. And I happened to talk to Tom. And Tom passed away He did. He's passed away in the last year, dear friend. But he began to challenge me on your true DNA. So when I talk about the mental domain, being curious, what are we reading? Second book I would recommend is When I Stop Talking, You'll Know I'm Dead. When I stop talking, you will know that I'm dead. It's written by Jerry Weintraub. Jerry was the Hollywood agent for Brad Pitt, John Denver, George Clooney. He was the mastermind behind Ocean's 11 and 12. Phenomenal read. And it's a book that I at least go through once a year. So mentally, I'm continuing to read. Right now, I probably have about 4 to 5 books going on at the same time. But I discovered the secret. The secret is you don't have to read the entire book. Go to the table of contents, look at the chapters that resonate with you, pick one chapter and start there. That's how you read the book, because nobody's holding a gun to your head asking you, did you finish the book? All right. And then emotionally is this ability to say, how am I doing? How am I ensuring from an emotional standpoint that I'm challenging myself every single day to be the best version of myself? So Shirley, you want me to list the books again? Thank you, Shirley, for bringing this to my attention. First book is called Your True DNA by Thomas Wininger, W-I-N-N-I-G-E-R, Thomas Wininger. And the second book is When I Stop Talking, You'll Know I'm Dead, Jerry Weintraub. Okay. And you can Google both of those names, and I'm sure the books will come up in Amazon. So we looked at four domains as it relates to curiosity: spirituality, physical, mental, and emotional. So emotional is so critically important. I just, let's see, do I have it here? Yes. I just took an assessment called the EQI assessment. And I have to cover this name because I'm coaching somebody right now, so I don't want you to see their name. But EQI is this whole emotional intelligence or emotional quotient assessment that I took, and I am administering this specifically for a coaching project that I'm doing with six amazing women over the next year, high-performing female leaders in a Fortune 100 company. And in this whole assessment, I have discovered that I have some areas that are a blind spot. What? That's right. I don't have all the answers. I'm still doing my work. You're welcome, Shirley. I'm still doing my work. So when I talk about emotional and truly being curious, who are the individuals that are closest to you? And what would it be like to ask them, give me feedback on how I'm showing up right now in the environment? I'm going to make just a couple more thoughts, and then I want to open up for questions that you may have, because I want to make sure that I end on time and don't wear out my welcome. So when you look at sparking your restart, and if I take you back to the very beginning, take your meds, look at hope, continue to be curious, I just want to introduce you to one more specific concept. And this is based on LinkedIn's latest research about the top 5 skills that are critically needed between now and 2025. No matter where you are in your journey, you may say, Simon, I'm volunteering as a mentor. I am supportive of the US Dream Academy. No matter where you are in the spectrum of how you engage with our awesome organization, I believe that these 5 skills are critically important no matter where you show up. Now, why are these 5 skills most important? In a world of algorithms, autonomous cars, artificial intelligence, and automation, the ability to reskill and upskill is so important. Skill number 1 is creativity. Skill number 2 is adaptability. There was an article about a year ago in the Washington Post entitled Adaptability is the New Essential Skill. So skill number two, adaptability. Third skill, collaboration. So this ability to say, how do I begin to interact in teams and different settings where, thank you so much, LeVar, where I know how to collaborate with people who may not look like me. I know how to collaborate and immerse myself in a group to get the best result. So collaboration, skill number three. Skill number four, storytelling, public speaking, the ability to present, critically important. Storytelling, a friend of mine is teaching a course right now internally at Stanford University called Data Storytelling. And what she is telling me is the power of data storytelling. It's not just enough to say, here's the data, but how do we truly humanize it through storytelling to connect the dots? And then skill number five, emotional intelligence. Dr. Dan Goleman, G-O-L-E-M-A-N, Goleman. Dr. Dan Goleman is really the father of emotional intelligence. And LeVar, do me a favor, if you just post Dr. Goleman's name in the comments, Goleman, G-O-L-E-M-A-N. So Coleman, but Goleman with a G. His book is Emotional Intelligence, and his follow-up book is Social Intelligence. So intellect is in the head, but intelligence is in the heart. And when I understand what we would call in caring science, how to read the field or read the room, I'm operating from a place of emotional intelligence when I release the need to be right, because I am authentically present to the moment. And when you are authentically present to the moment, when you look at those five skills, creativity, adaptability, collaboration, storytelling, persuasion, public speaking, emotional intelligence, I would invite you, Socratic method of learning, to say which one of those five skills resonate with you. And how do you, in sparking your restart, go deeper in developing that skill? If you know someone who's really effective at any of the five skills that I've identified, what would it be like to connect with them and say, walk me through what is a strength for you is a weakness for me? And how can what is a strength for me may be a weakness for you? How do we begin to learn from each other? So I'll just be curious and post in the chat, which one of the five skills resonates with you the most as you spark your restart? And which one are you gonna work on? Which one are you curious about? Which one really like resonates with you and speaks to you deeply, okay? All right, so LeVar, how about we open up for any questions that individuals may have? And I'll be happy to answer as many questions as possible. I'll give you a few seconds. Give you a few seconds to ask a question.
And please post your questions in the chat.
And while you're thinking of your questions, I would also invite you to share what's resonated with you thus far, what's been a reminder. Please let me know. That would help me a great deal to know what's resonating with you. What have you taken away? Everybody is quiet. Now, I know that LeVar will highlight if there are any questions. So while we're waiting for questions to come in, I'll tell you just a little bit about my odd book collection here. But these are some of my favorite books that I have read. Barbara, I see that you posted how. So just let us know what the specific question is. Please repeat the restart components. Take your meds. Okay. Thank you, Sandra. So meds, meditate, exercise,
diet, sleep, meds. Don't forget to take your meds, okay? Who else? So while you're thinking of your questions, another book that I would recommend is this book called Future Think. Edie Widener is a futurist. I've shared the stage with her. Phenomenal, phenomenal human being, great thinker. And one of my favorite quotes from Edie is, some people know so much about what they know that they are the last to see the future differently. And powerful, powerful quote when you think about that. So Future Think. Barbara says, what's a good first step? Let's promote that if you could. LeVar, if you can promote this so I could see it. Barbara says, what's a good first step to move from negative energy to a more positive outlook? Okay, Barbara, thank you for this question. The moment you sense you might be spiraling down, staying in a negative zone, pause for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. And flip the thought into something that you are A, grateful for, B, appreciate, C, love. Okay. Now, why? Why do you flip it? Because the moment you flip the thought, before that thought goes too far into your psyche, what you're really doing is you are shifting your belief system from spiraling down because beliefs create behaviors, behaviors create habits. Reverse engineer habits come from behaviors, behaviors come from beliefs, beliefs come from thoughts. So 3 seconds, flip it by something you're grateful for, something you appreciate, and think about that. That is how you can begin to take control of the steering wheel of your mind to prevent you from spiraling down in a negative place, and appreciating, being grateful, being thankful allows you to spiral up and operate in a higher frequency, okay? Charissa, let's promote this question. What are some tips that you have for connecting and collaborating with others who may not be in tune with their own emotional intelligence, leveling the playing field, if you will? Okay. So individuals who may not be self-aware, a good thing to do is to identify when you talk to them, or if you're starting to engage with them or collaborate with them, number one, what's their learning style? How do you figure out a person's learning style? Listen to their speech pattern. What is it that they're saying? What is their word choice? What is their lexicon? What is their phraseology? All right, and make a mental post-it note of how they express themselves. That's number one. Number two, what would it be like to compliment or thank them or celebrate what they do? And it might be minor to you, but a big deal to them, to say, oh my goodness, that's your job? What a great job. Or thank you for volunteering. Or find something positive to validate who they are. Why is that important? Dr. Maria Muzik, M-U-Z-I-K, is a clinical psychiatrist at the University of Michigan. And 30 years of her research, she says individuals need 3 things to be seen, valued, and understood. So Charissa, when I'm really looking to engage with someone, how do I begin to understand or compliment them just in something that might be small? All right, third, as you probably can tell with me, there's always 3. The other thing to think about in collaboration is to start with a question and just say, hey, we have this opportunity. What do you think is the best approach to ensure that we are successful? Language, very important. So it's not about me, it's about we. Asking a question immerses them on a quest, inviting them in to say, what?
You want to know what I think? Yes. And it's a way to really help individuals who may not be in tune with their EQ or their EI. All right. Leveling the playing field, if you will, is always how do we honor something that we talk about in Karen Science is how do we honor humanity where they are by understanding what makes them tick. And that only comes through open dialogue, conversation, to really engage them and awaken them to what's possible, okay? All right, I think we've got time for one more question. Hopefully it helps you, Sharissa, and everyone. One more question. Is there one more question? Now you're probably saying, is there another book while we're waiting for questions? So I'll go to this side. One of the books that I really love is actually two. Tools for Titans by Tim Ferriss. Tactics, Routines, Habits of Billionaires, Icons, and World-Class Performers. Great, great read. And this is a highlighter, dog ear the page. It's really good. A book that I picked up at a used bookstore. This book was written back in the 1940. And you probably still can get it. It's called Thinking on Your Feet. I am paid to think on my feet in the moment. And I've been doing what you're experiencing right now, me virtually having this conversation with you. I've been doing this for 40 years. All right. I know I look young. But Think on Your Feet is a great book written by Louis Niezer, N-I-Z-E-R. And the introduction is by Bruce Barton, who was one of the fathers of the advertising industry. But what I think is so critically important right now is this ability to stand flat foot, tell your story, make your point, and feel your spark, live into your spark, be the spark. So I'm going to say something that sounds very left coast, that is West Coast. When everybody steps into your quantum field, they can pick up on your energy that you indeed are the spark. So in other words, when you walk into the room, you're not in the room is in you. What? That's a joy bomb. The room is in you because you are the spark that everyone has been waiting for. So when you begin to understand how to take your meds, realize that hope is your superpower. The ability to upgrade your verbal software, to be hopeful in your languaging. And as people begin to connect, they hear the hope. And if they are in a negative zone, your hope perhaps allows them to spiral up. They can now get on the same frequency because frequently you are a person coming from a place of hope. Then this ability to be curious, to ask questions, the quality of your questions determine the quality of your thinking. So how do I begin to ask questions and for who I become in the process? And that, my friend, is just a few thoughts on how to spark your restart. I am Simon T. Bailey. I am so happy that you are part of the US Dream Academy. For more information, please go to simontbailey.com, T for terrific. Oh, also, I forgot. So the wonderful, amazing folks at Black News Channel, BNC, has given me a TV show. So I have a TV show that comes on every Saturday and Sunday, 9:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, called Spark You with Simon T. That's me. What? And in the show, I do teaching. I take you into a live experience. I interview authors, thought leaders. The one this weekend is going to be amazing. It's with a gentleman named John Fleming, who wrote a book called The Ultimate Gig. And he unpacks everything going on in the gig economy. But net, BNC, just check your cable listing, or if you have cut the cord and you watch it on streaming platforms, you can see it on Roku, Pluto TV, any of the streaming platforms, but it's called Spark You. And we've been on now almost 30 weeks. Really, really excited about the show. Thank you so much for your time. You can also, when you go to my website, simontbailey.com, all of my books are there. You can go to Amazon and you can put in my name and it'll come up. All right, I'm gonna quit because I'm not gonna wear out my welcome because Diane will not invite me back. She was like, you went over time. All right, take care.
Thank you, Simon. Thank you. Excellent presentation.
Thank you.